We have two gospel lessons this morning. Our first comes from Luke chapter 6, verses 27 through 36. But I say to you that listen, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from anyone who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt. Give to everyone who begs from you, and if anyone takes away your goods, do not ask for them again. Do to others as you would have them do to you. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. If you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. If you lend to those from whom you hope to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to receive as much again. But love your enemies, do good, and lend, expecting nothing in return. Your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. And the second reading comes from John chapter 13, verses 31 through 35. When he had gone out, Jesus said, Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I'm only with you a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you should also love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
We've spent the past few weeks celebrating the good news of Jesus' resurrection in the Easter season. But in our lectionary text today from John, which we see show up a lot on Maundy Thursday, and in the second text that I chose to go along with it from Luke, we're increasingly having to ask ourselves the question, now that Christ's resurrection has changed the world, what are we being called to do about it? And Jesus' answer to that question is this, and just this, love one another. On the surface, seems like a fairly simple command, doesn't it? Love one another. But I think that if we're honest, we all know that living out those three simple words is a lot more difficult than it sounds. Now, I suppose that I could go into some deep theological mumbo-jumbo about historical context and all of the passage and blah, 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 but while that stuff is important, it's for another day. Today, I want for us to think about what Jesus is calling us and commanding us to do. Love one another. Not just the people that we already love, but also the people who, for whatever reason, are hardest for us to love. And today, we're called to look within and to be honest with ourselves about who those people might be and to work to do better. Because Jesus tells us that when we love one another, that's the mark for the whole world of who we are and of who and what we stand for. After all, Jesus tells his disciples, I won't be around for forever, and you can't come with me where I'm going. I'm going into the darkness. But you, my dear ones, are the sign of who I am and what I'm about. And the world will know all about it if you love one another. And when we think about that, and as we pair this command with Jesus' words in Luke, that as his followers, we also have to love our enemies, living out the good news becomes a lesson in tough love. After all, the mark of our faith for the world won't come in how we treat the people we love the most, but it will come in how we treat the people we love the least. So today, I have an exercise for us, so convenient that we are in this space. And the exercise is called Transforming Enemy Images. It comes from Dr. Teresa Latini, who's a professor of practical theology and pastoral care at Western Theological Seminary. And it's an exercise that helps us come to a place where we take the person or the group of people that we find most difficult to love and be at a point where we can see them just a little bit better, the way God might see them, as a beloved child of God. Now, whether we want to admit it or not, we all have someone or some group of people who just rubs us the wrong way, who we can't quite understand, someone who's hurt us deeply, or someone whose actions we think fall from the mark of what we believe is right for the world. In other words, we have what Dr. Latini calls an enemy image. I want you to get that person or that group of people in your mind as I walk you through this exercise, and y'all should have worksheets in your bulletins. If you do not have one of those, let me know. There should also be pencils or pens on your table. This exercise is for you and you alone. No one else has to see this. I will never see this. This is a time for you to be honest inside your own heart, and I'll walk you through this process, and hopefully at the end, whoever that person or group is, you'll have a little bit more insight into them and into yourself. So this process is based on Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and the quote at the top essentially says, when the opportunity presents itself for you to defeat your enemy, that is the time when you must not do it. There will come a time in many instances when the person who hates you most, the person who has misused you most, the person who has gossiped about you most, the person who has spread false rumors about you most, there will come a time when you will have an opportunity to defeat that person. Might be in terms of a recommendation for a job. Might be in terms of helping that person to make some move in life. That's the time you must do it. That is the meaning of love. In the final analysis, love is not this sentimental something that we talk about. Not merely an emotional something. Love is creative, understanding goodwill for all men. It's the refusal to defeat any individual. When you rise to the level of love, of its great beauty and power, you seek only to defeat evil systems. The understanding that comes from this is that we do not defeat people, we defeat systems that cause people to get trapped in cycles that are unhealthy, that cause them to move towards sin. So we seek to dismantle those systems while preserving the individual, that this is the meaning of loving our enemy. So in your mind, if you want to write it down, identify some person or group for whom you hold what Latini calls an enemy image. So be thinking about that for this exercise. Now, she uses the example, if you're having a hard time, and if you're kind of wondering about the concept of the group of people, she uses the example of the Luddite. That somebody might have strong feelings about a Luddite who just cannot grasp technology and this idea of that person being stuck in the past instead of moving forward in the future. And so she used that as an example. So when we get to step two, write down your thoughts, evaluations, and judgments of this person or group. Again, this is only as helpful as you are honest with yourself, and no one is going to see these. So when you think about that person or group that just really rubs you the wrong way, what are those snap images or judgments that come to mind? So for example, with the Luddite, old-fashioned, or trapped in the past, or resistant to change, whatever it may be that is kind of your concept for that person or group, be thinking about it or write it down if that's helpful for you. you're thinking about those sort of images that come to mind or phrases or words to describe that person or that group, think now about what triggers that. What is something that that group or that person says or does that immediately brings those images to mind? So we're connecting thoughts and judgments now to the actions that cause us to create those images. Now on step four, what we're moving from is from the other person, and now we need to learn how to be honest with ourselves about ourselves. If you flip your page over, there's something called a needs inventory that comes from the Center for Nonviolent Communication. And when we have somebody who really rubs us the wrong way, it's because that person or that group of people is rubbing up against something that's important to us, that they are somehow opposing some value that is so deeply a part of who we are that it creates this almost knee-jerk reaction. So in, for the example of the Luddite, the need may have been creativity. That creativity is a value, and if we're always stuck doing what we're always stuck doing, then we don't have an opportunity to try something new. So if creativity is something, that may be the need that's rubbing the wrong way. Or it may be community, a need for community, that if somebody's not willing to kind of follow us where we're going, then that is a breach of relationship. So look at this needs inventory. When you think about that person or that group, and about the actions that cause you to be so frustrated, what needs do you have that are not being met or that are being pushed up against by that person or that group? And now comes the hard part, y'all. Now that you've had some time to assess what your own needs are, what do you think are the needs motivating that person to do what they're doing? This is not condoning the person or the group's actions, particularly if they're doing something harmful, illegal, etc., etc. But this is, people act out of needs, even if they act in a way that seems disordered to us, okay? So we need to put ourselves in that other person's shoes to try to empathize, to try to understand what's motivating that person, what needs are they trying to meet in doing whatever it is that they're doing. And again, it's helpful to look at the needs and thank you. then the final step in this process that Teresa Latini does is, now I'm assuming that your person is not in this room. That may not be true. Your person may be in this room, or your group may be in this room, whatever it is. But are there requests that you can think of that you could make of this person or this group that might help contribute to either their needs or your needs? Or even better, if you find that there are needs that you both have that kind of overlap, what are some things that you might be able to do, or conversations you might be able to have, if you have the opportunity, to help understand one another's needs better? Okay, by either nodding of heads or blinking of eyes or blank stares, are you at a slightly different place in your thinking about this person or group than you were when you started the exercise? A little bit? I'm seeing some shy head nods. Some shy head nods. This is just something, it's a process to think through. It helps us to find a way to love our enemies by, instead of making them an other, it helps us to understand our motivations, it helps us to understand their motivations, and it helps us to understand that these are human beings who are beloved by God, who have needs, who have things that drive them, and they may be at opposition with us, but we're not there to break down that person. We're there to break down the walls that divide us from one another. This morning, we have the chance to rejoice in the good news of a risen Savior who loved us even to the gift of his own life that was given and that he was raised again. And so as we rejoice in that, let us search our hearts for how we can live out the simple three words that are also the hardest three words: seeking to love our enemies who are also our neighbors, so that the world will see a love greater than us that conquers even death. Hallelujah.